Hello. How are you,
Hello, how are
Teacher
you?
Fiona? Pretty good.
Yes,
I'm pretty good.
nice to
Nice to meet
meet
you too. Likewise.
and thank you for taking the time today
My
as well.
pleasure. My pleasure. Why not? I am basically interviewing teachers around the world to get some insight and, good suggestions and ideas, which is, I think, really cool. Not just for teachers, but also for students too, right?
Absolutely, yeah.
Okay, very good. So, without losing any time, let's just start. Teacher Fiona, speaking of motivation, how can we motivate language learners?
Okay, interesting question. So my answer here might be a little bit controversial because I kind of think that actually a lot of the responsibility for motivation is on the student. And obviously this is different, I think, for adults and children. And my experience is mainly with adults, so I'm talking mainly about adult students. But there's a lot of, I hear a lot of talk about how as teachers we need to kind of motivate all the time, motivate our students to learn and all of this. And you know, I speak both as a teacher and a student as
Really?
well. You know, a lot of this, it's not the teacher's responsibility really to, we can advise you, we can give you tips and ways to maybe keep yourself motivated, but yeah, I think the responsibility is on the student. So speaking as a student, there are a few ways that I do this. When I tell my students this as well, and for myself, I do it. When I have first started learning a language, I always make a list of my objectives, of my goals. So basically, the why. Why am I doing this to myself? Why am I learning this language? And it's, yeah, you know, just keep it somewhere close to you. You know, keep that list somewhere close so that when you do have those moments of, oh, this is way too difficult, then you can refer back to that list and remind yourself why you're doing this and what your long-term objectives are. And another kind of useful little tip as well, that I do with myself, when I have a lesson, and I learn some new language, generally I challenge myself by giving myself a couple of like translation sentences. So I will think about the language that I have learnt, maybe in that class or in the last few classes. And I will write some sentences in English that I should be able to translate. And usually it's quite difficult. It takes a while because it's new language. But I do that and I keep it. And then maybe 2 months, 3 months or longer down the line, I will look again at those sentences. And 9 times out of 10, when I look at them again, it will be easy. And I go, oh, okay, I have learned something. Maybe I feel like I haven't, but I have. I have learned quite a lot in these last 3 months. So that's a good way to kind of keep yourself motivated as well. But yeah, just I think,
Nice
yeah, one
approach.
more thing, I suppose. Just yeah, just access. So yeah, thinking about why. Why are you doing it?
Very nice. Yeah, nice approach actually. Okay, so what is the difference between young learners and adults?
So, honestly, most of my experience has been with adults. I have been teaching since 2012, and I taught children for 1 year, and it was a lovely, lovely year. I really enjoyed it, but it was a lot of work. Do you teach children or adults or both?
I used to teach children, but not at all. Right now, I basically teach adults. Yeah. Children, no, adults, yes.
It's a very rewarding experience, but it just takes so much energy.
Absolutely.
Like it's, yeah, and it's a lot of entertaining. And of course, the learning is very different as well. I find, you know, again, going back to that first question, you know, you don't, you do have to motivate kids, actually. You do, and you don't with adults, and that's a big difference. And obviously there are differences in the way that you learn the language as well. You can, kids sort of absorb it a little bit more, and adults you have to actually explain. And something that always makes me very sad as well with adults, there is always an element of fear and shame, particularly with English more than other languages, which isn't there with most kids. They don't feel embarrassed to make a mistake. So there are some differences, but I'm not going to pretend to be an expert in the learning processes, because I don't have the experience.
You're right, actually. Yeah, I mean, what I have learned from the teaching experience, actually, I'm talking about the kids are fast learners, really fast and really clever. But adults, as you said, they are self-judgmental. They judge themselves a lot. And that is why maybe they cannot come out of their comfort zone, right? And which is really challenging. But of course, one of the most positive thing about adults is they are goal-oriented, actually, right? I mean, they have goals and they do whatever it is to reach that goal. This is what I love from it, I mean, about adults, actually, so to speak. Yeah.
Yeah.
Very good.
Yeah, but it's a big difference. It's a big difference. Yeah, and you can reason. You can explain and reason with adults and talk about those goals as well. And yeah, you can't have children.
Okay, I mean, I received this question a lot. What are the probable problems of students while they are studying and learning?
So I think, well, the thing I hear most often, I'm sure you can relate to this as well, when I'm doing that sort of first needs assess with a student and I say, you know, what is your biggest problem? What's the biggest challenge that you find with English? The response will always be speaking, the ability to speak. And I think that's particularly the case in a lot of European countries, is that in schools, and this might be the same elsewhere, but I don't know, you know, in schools, the children learn a lot of grammar, lots of kind of, you know, changing active voice into passive voice exercises, this kind of thing. But they don't really learn to speak. And again, that sort of self, you know, judgmental element that you mentioned comes into it as well. So that I think is the biggest challenge that most students tell me, the biggest problem. And I think that it can seem like a big problem and a big challenge if you're living in a country that you're not surrounded by English, you're not, you know, when you have to self-immerse, basically, you have to kind of create your own immersive English-speaking environment to practice and find ways to reproduce the language. It can be challenging, and that's something that we can help students with, definitely. But yeah, to answer your question, that I think is the biggest problem, is just the speaking.
Exactly. Yeah, that is true. And okay, what sort of material as a teacher would you recommend them to use? I mean, yeah, books, apps, websites, platforms, digital, online, offline.
So the first thing I would say is that I think luckily with English more than other languages, there is just so much on the internet. There are so many resources, free resources, you know, that you really just have a world of options. So I think it will depend very much on the student as to what resources, what apps, what materials suit them as a learner. But definitely there will be something available for you. Regarding apps, the British Council do some really, really nice free apps. They do like a grammar app, a storytelling app. They're brilliant. And also the British Council website is particularly good as well. BBC Learning English is another great one. I love their Instagram feed and all of their videos. I think they explain things really clearly and just in a really nice, friendly way. Yeah, and all sorts. And if your level is sort of intermediate upwards, I think there are quite a few good like authentic English media as well. And I think in one of your videos you mentioned about watching series and kind of almost, you know, modeling one a character that you see again and again speaking in a series. And I think this is good advice. And I think, again, coming back to that question, one of motivation, if the resources and the materials and the media that you're consuming in your target language, if you like it, that is the main thing, because that's going to motivate you. So, you know, if you want to read in English, the number one thing is just read something you like, I think.
Okay, grammar and vocabulary, which one is really important and why? How can learners improve their grammar and vocab?
Okay, so to answer your first question, I think both are important. I think if you're learning from zero, which I imagine maybe you're not if you're watching this video, I don't know, but if you are learning from zero, then probably vocabulary is most important. Because even as you're learning the grammar, if you don't have the vocabulary, then you can't reproduce those structures. You can't practice and build fluency with that grammar. So vocabulary is most important, I think, for low-level learners. And again, perhaps actually for very high level. So at both ends of the spectrum, maybe vocabulary becomes more important, but between sort of, you know, C2 and A1 level, I think both really. Would you agree
exactly,
with that?
Exactly, of course. Yeah. Majority of the teachers, I mean, think that vocabulary outweighs the grammar, because mostly we teach based on students' needs, right? And basically, as you mentioned earlier, you know, majority of students are looking for having a very comfortable speaking practice, right? I mean, speaking ability.
Yeah.
So for speaking, I would definitely say, vocabulary. Go for vocab. I mean, majority of the students complain about just, they say, teacher, we can understand, but we cannot talk. I would say because of the lack of the vocab. I mean, you can understand, but you haven't learned that vocabulary completely. That is why I think that is why they cannot reproduce the language, you know, effectively. But grammar, of course, if you want to have a sort of standard English, standard language, definitely grammar is number one factor in this.
Yeah. And I think that's a good point. I think sometimes it's also important to think about when thinking about vocabulary, think about active and passive vocabulary as well. And that's something that, yeah, exactly as you said, a lot of my students kind of come to me and say, oh yeah, I understand everything, but I just can't speak. And it is then to work on changing that passive vocabulary into active vocabulary just by constant reproduction of it. And that's a good point as well. I mean, grammar, I think just for me personally, I think daily study is the best. And I know people don't want to hear this because they're, oh, I want to learn English just by watching TV. But no, you do need to study. And I think short periods of study during the day. So don't kind of wait until Friday or Saturday and sit down for 2 hours and try to study everything, because it's not going to work. So just 20 minutes a day, or 20 minutes every 2 days, even if you don't have the time, is better. I would advise, personally, I love these three books, you know, the Murphy's Grammar, the red one, blue one, and green one. I think they are the best for grammar. revisit as well to make sure that what you're learning doesn't just go into the short-term memory and disappear, that it actually gets put into your long-term memory as well. So, you know, if you're learning, you know, if you've studied one page of the Murphy's Blue Book, for example, and you think, great, I understand this, don't just move on to the next one and never revisit. Always come back to it, you know, a week or 2 weeks later, just to make sure, just to build that foundation. And languages can't be crammed. They cannot be done quickly. You know, you have to, if you're going to learn a language, it will take you time. So I think being patient is important.
Absolutely.
There.
Absolutely.
So regards grammar, that, you know, there are lots of different little tricks that you can do, but generally just study and write and reproduce as much as possible. And for vocabulary, I think if you can try to listen to authentic material as much as possible. I find, I don't know how you feel about this, but I see a lot of like Instagram posts and posts in Facebook learning groups specifically teaching vocabulary, and quite often when something is presented as a synonym, for example, it's not really an exact synonym. It's not quite what it is saying that it is. I think actually getting vocabulary from an authentic source, like a series or videos or podcasts, is a much better way to
do it. Exactly. Yeah, I mean, some teachers are trying to just teach those vocabulary that, as you said, maybe they are not standard enough for language users or language learners. Yeah, totally right.
Yeah. One thing to add as well. I know I'm talking a lot. But yeah, one thing to add is, another thing I see a lot and that I hear a lot from students are these differences between British and American English.
We will talk about it.
And I think there's a lot of focus.
we will talk about that. Yes.
Brilliant. Okay. Okay. Great.
I mean, question number five may be, of course, a silly question to ask from a native speaker, but let's ask, how did you personally learn English?
So I'm glad you asked that question. Yeah, and I was born in the UK. So my parents speak English, and I grew up in an English-speaking environment. So that's how I learned.
Which part of UK, may I ask?
Brighton, in the south. Really? So we have a lot of language schools in Brighton. It's very famous for people coming to study languages.
For non-native speakers, right?
Yeah.
Very good. That's cool. It says here, is it possible to learn multiple languages at the same time? And would you recommend doing that?
I wouldn't, personally. I don't know what your thoughts are on this. Personally, I wouldn't. I find, again, speaking as both teacher and student, I find I have space in my head for one language that other than my native language. So, you know, I find it difficult. I used to live in Spain, so I learned Spanish in Spain. And I remember while I was there studying Spanish, I also decided, I'm going to learn Arabic, because it's a beautiful language. I'm going to try to learn that one. And because I was learning both, so often I would forget some vocabulary in one language and the word would come from the other language, and I would end up with just completely mixed sentences. I would confuse sort of grammar structures and start questioning things that I had, quite basic things that I had already learned, just because they're different in the other language. I think it's, and I've seen this with students as well. You know, I have a student at the moment who's a Spanish student who's learning English and also French. And quite often she produces French vocabulary in the lesson as well. So it's, I think they do mix, and I don't think you can help it. What do you think?
I couldn't agree with you more. You know, you're totally correct on this. Of course, there is a huge mixture of course, pronunciation, of course, the translation. I mean, I never, you know, ever recommend that. And you're the first teacher among my those teachers that I interviewed who said, no, I don't recommend it. And yeah, I agree with you on this question. Totally correct. Yeah. Totally.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, unless you want to suffer, then go
exactly
ahead.
Exactly. Yeah, very cliche question, everybody's favorite. How can learners improve their speaking abilities? Sick and tired. I am sick and tired of this.
I think it's a good question. I think it's a good question because, you know, as I mentioned, I still now, many years later, now I've decided I want to learn Arabic. And this is one problem I'm having. And I really notice the difference between having learned Spanish in a Spanish-speaking environment and trying to learn Arabic in an English-speaking environment. It's finding those opportunities to speak is quite challenging. So I do understand why students ask this. And again, there's that element of fear and shame as well in speaking. So there are a few different ways, and I made a couple of notes about this one as well. So the first thing to kind of remember, I think, is that we normally think about speaking and listening on the one side and reading and writing on the other. And I think this needs to change a little bit. And we need to start thinking about sort of receptive skills and productive skills. So, you know, language coming in and language going out. And productive skills are writing and speaking. Now, because it's a similar process, writing actually will help with your speaking. So the more you write and the more you kind of practice these structures in a way that you've actually got time to think about what you're doing, to use, look up new vocabulary and incorporate that in what you're producing, the more you write, the better you will speak, basically. So because you're reproducing those structures in both skills. So I think writing is one thing that helps absolutely with that. There is a word for this, but I can't remember what it is. So another thing that helps is like mimicking other speakers as well. So if you have somebody that you like the sound of, or whoever, if you're watching a series, just take a fragment of their speech and just repeat it again and again and again, replay the original speaker, repeat again and again until you think that you have got it right. Because a big part of it is actually the muscles and actually making those shapes. You know, they're going to be different in your language. So a big part of it is not necessarily actually thinking of the language to reproduce, but getting your mouth physically comfortable with making those sounds. So mimicking speakers, repeating is a good way to do that as
nice.
Well. Speaking whenever you can. I've got a long list actually, but I'm not going to go through it all.
Of course, because this question is really important question, really common question.
Yeah.
Please go ahead. Yeah.
I think speaking, you will probably find if you're learning English or any other language, you have these moments where you just think of the language, you think in the language. Maybe you're making a coffee and you just, you know, you're stirring the coffee and you're thinking, oh yeah, I know how to say I make coffee. And you think about these things in your head. And I always say, when those moments come, verbalize it, say it, you know, don't just think it, actually say it aloud, and try as much as possible to do that throughout the day. So actually produce language. It doesn't actually matter whether it's grammatically correct or not, just say it. So that's important, because it is there is this barrier, and it's a big barrier between here and here. And the more you can get things through it, the better. So do that whenever you have the opportunity to. And something that came up the other day, actually, that I was having this conversation with one of my students about, productive skills and writing. And she was saying that she found it quite difficult to write because, as with many students, she got hung up on the grammar when she was writing. It wasn't sort of fluent writing, and she has quite a good level. But she was struggling. She was, she'd write half the sentence and then start questioning herself about whether that was the correct structure to use or not. So we talked about it a little bit, and we kind of changed tack. And what we're now doing is she's actually listening to native speakers or fluent speakers, writing down their speech, and then producing it again verbally. And she says this is helping her because it stops that block of like not think, you don't have to think about what you're producing, but you're receiving it, like, in your ears. You're then reproducing it in writing. You're then producing it again, verbally. So, that is quite a few stages that it's going through, and hopefully getting into your kind of active language. So, yeah, and there are lots of ways. Grammar, if you're struggling with grammar, sometimes I do this when looking at things like conditionals or like past perfect, slightly more complex, difficult grammar, is I ask students to write down a couple of sentences with that grammar that are relevant to their lives. And this is important as well, actually, that if the language you're learning can be used to express yourself, not some fictional character from a book, but actually you, then you're going to remember it better. So, use that language, write down like three or four sentences using the grammar that you're studying at the moment, and read out those sentences, read them aloud in the morning, first thing in the morning, and if you have time before you go to bed as well. But it does work, and it sounds weird and hocus pocus, but I promise you it does work. If it's the first thing you say in the morning, you will remember it. So, and these are things you can do without actually speaking to somebody. Of course, that is a brilliant way to do it as well. Go on iTalki, find a language partner, join WhatsApp groups, leave voice messages. This actually speaking, having conversations is, of course, the best way, but it's not the only way.
Very good. Thank you very much. Yeah, really unique, suggestions. And
good luck.
Yeah. Okay. Next question is accent and pronunciation and American English versus British English. Which one?
Okay, so this is another great question. I saw a really good little post on Instagram the other day, which was, I'll see if I can find it and send it to you. It was somebody stepping up stairs, walking up stairs, and they were stepping over about three or four steps, and trying to stretch over, and on the top step it said accent, and on all the ones they had missed it was things like clear pronunciation, grammar, vocabulary, everything else. And this is something that I have experienced, is students who just focus for some reason on accent, that they want a British accent, because I'm British, this is what I get asked for. And I think this comes last. So this is quite an important point. When you can pronounce clearly, the standard should be mutual intelligibility. It shouldn't be sounding like a British person or sounding like an American person. It's if you can pronounce clearly and make yourself understood, then that is key. And I think personally, I think that's where you should stop. I don't really understand the desire for a British or an American accent, but that's my personal point of view. And what was the other part of your question?
Actually, yeah, we were talking about accent or pronunciation, which one students should basically focus on a lot. And of course, you answered the American English or British English, actually, in terms of accents, maybe.
I mean, this is what I get asked about. I get asked about American or British English. Personally, I kind of think we should just forget these kind of accents and just focus on pronouncing clearly. I, you know, for me, you know, when I'm learning languages, and I think for my students as well, I don't really want to hear students trying to mimic an accent. I just think it's important that the pronunciation is clear and that communication is easy and not impaired by, you know, bad pronunciation. That is most important. And of course, there are many other countries that have English as their national language apart from the US and England or the UK as well. So
yeah, that is not a big, you know, thing to just be obsessed with, you say.
I do feel that there is that, yeah. And you know, maybe there's a point that I'm not understanding. What's your view on this? Because for me, it's kind of like, why does everybody want to speak like an English person or speak like an American person? But how do you see that?
Yeah, actually, there isn't any definite answer for this. But what I feel about the intention of students is maybe they do not want to be outsiders. This is the only feeling that I have. Imagine that a non-native speaker travels to your country and if he or she starts talking about something, right, you can immediately understand that the person is not a native speaker. So maybe that person can be an outsider. This is my feeling, actually.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. And one thing I think it's worth remembering, and just, you know, for anyone who's watching this video, is that actually, you know, British native English speakers are vastly in the minority of English speakers. And I wish I had the numbers to hand, but I can't remember them.
I heard that
but
too,
there are so many more, you know, people. Actually, even when I was teaching in Spain, I was teaching in businesses so that my students, you know, or middle management to partner level, so that they could do business in English. And hardly any of them were doing business with native English speakers. It was people in Spain wanting to do business with people in France or people in China. You know, none of them, they were all English speakers, but they didn't need to do business with native speakers. Nobody needed a native speaker accent. They just needed to be understood mutually. And that was it. But you're not an outsider. You massively are in the majority.
Okay, thank you. Next question is, is it possible to learn English without going abroad? Or going abroad is a must?
I think it's, of course it is. Of course. Yeah, I think it's totally possible. I think, as we kind of mentioned earlier, it's more difficult, I think, because you have to create this immersive environment for yourself. You know, it's not there already. But I have met some, you know, yourself included, you know, some incredible, you know, English Thank speakers you. Who, I don't know, have you lived abroad?
Unfortunately, no.
Okay, another example to add to my list. So, I've met and worked with teachers actually online. I worked with a really, really great teacher from Iraq who had never left Iraq, and he was working in the American university there teaching English. His English was exceptional. So yeah, I think it's more difficult, but it's absolutely possible. Yeah.
Very good. Yeah. And how long will it take for a person to really learn every necessary elements of language to speak it properly? This is a sort of academic question. Yeah.
Yeah. I think, again, this depends on the student. It depends on that immersive environment. It depends on your need. And it depends on how much time you put into it. What I will say is you don't become fluent in, you know, a couple of months. It takes time.
Absolutely.
But, you know, when I, using my own sort of experiences as an example, when I moved to Spain, I had colleagues who moved to Spain without a word of Spanish and were fluent within a year. You know, they put the work in, they studied, they practiced, they took every opportunity to learn. But within a year, they were fluent. So, and of course, I think it depends.
Exactly. And we have the final question, technology and education. Do you think that the integration of these two, I don't know what to call it, concept or factor or whatever, is a good idea or can be a harmful idea?
I think it's inevitable. I think it's unavoidable. And actually, I see it as really positive. I think it depends how you use it. And I think, I don't know what generation you are, but for me, for my generation and older, I think it can be quite challenging because, you know, young people now, they grow up almost with, you know, the internet as a kind of second language almost. It's a, you know,
almost like first language.
They know.
Yeah. First language, actually. 24/7, yes. All the time they are, you know, doing something on their telephones, attached to their telephones a lot.
Exactly. And I remember, I don't know if you saw it, there's a little video that went around on the internet a while ago of this toddler who was looking at a magazine. And she touched the magazine and tried to make the picture bigger on the paper, not understanding that it wasn't a computer screen. You know, I think.
No, I haven't watched that. So, I haven't seen that.
It's terrifying.
Really terrifying.
But I mean, again, this is, you can't change things. This is the way that it's going, and there are huge benefits to everybody being so connected, to being able to do things in many ways more efficiently, more quickly. So I think the older teachers among us need to learn how to use it to its best advantage. And I think there has been a real boost in that learning because of this pandemic. I think a lot of people have had to learn it, and they have.
This is positive.
But I think, I think overall it's positive. I think there's a lot that can be done. And I just want to mention as well, one project that I was working on, not last year, but the year before, I think, with an organization called Language Beyond Borders. And it was an organization that delivered online English classes to people living in refugee camps. And it was absolutely necessary, and it never would have been possible without the internet, without the fact that everybody now has a mobile phone, you know, with internet access or data. So, you know, there are huge, huge benefits to it as well. We just have to learn how to use it properly.
Absolutely. So do you basically use technology in your actual environment, like classrooms, not online. I'm talking about actual classroom. Do you use technology a lot?
Well, I'm a little bit behind on this because I've been teaching online for a while now, for the last couple of years.
I see.
So things like digital whiteboards, this kind of thing, I'm a little bit behind because I kind of went from teaching in Spain just with a normal whiteboard and no tech to teaching online. So I don't really have the experience of using tech in the classroom.
I see. Yeah, interesting. Of course, possible. It depends. It depends on the teacher, actually, as you said, and how we are using this technology. Of course, but I would say the balance is actually the case. I mean, if you just use technology too much, I'm talking about the actual one, actually, maybe people would be distracted from the lessons that we are actually presenting. Or if we just remove it, again, we have that traditional old-fashioned way of teaching, which is not really interesting. I mean the balance is really the case, I would say. But I'm a huge fan of technology myself, really a huge fan of technology. But yeah, I would say the balance is really the case.
And I think that's a good point as well, that it can be distracting. And I think if it's not used in the right way, if it's used like a gimmick, you know, as just a fun extra novelty in the classroom, then yeah, it can actually, I suppose, distract from the learning rather than benefit it. Yeah, that's a good point.
Very good.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much for participating and, you know, accepting my invitation.
Thank you.
For this lovely interview. And yeah, very, very thank you for that. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It was really a pleasure to meet you and talk about teaching.
Of course.
I don't know how long it's been.
I don't know.
40 minutes,
maybe,
I think.
Maybe longer than that. Of course. No problem, actually. Good.
Well, thank you very much. You mentioned are you not working at the moment because of the pandemic, or you're just working from home?
Of course, we are working, actually. We go to schools. Yeah. But we are wearing, face shields or, mask. Oof. Yeah,
wow.
Exactly. We do this. And students, have to, again, wear masks.
Oh my gosh.
I mean, the whole thing actually transformed and changed. And we have to get used to it. Yeah. But we go. We continue doing this.
Yeah, let's just hope it's over soon, I guess.
I hope to. Until vaccination, I think the life will be like this. Vaccination can change it, can return this life to the previous one, to the previous one, yeah, I would say.
Yeah.
Until that time, no, I don't think.
Yeah.
Because people do not pay attention to the doctors and the medicine, the medical procedures, everything. I mean, people just neglect it. And even if one person does not follow the rules, again, the whole society is at risk, unfortunately.
Mm. It's interesting here. It's kind of similar here. We're very divided. People who are very strictly following the rules and people who think it's all just
a joke,
at nothing, it's nothing, it doesn't matter. And of course, like you said, it just takes a couple of people and everybody's at risk.
Absolutely. Unfortunately.
Yeah, it's tricky.
Unfortunately.
Well, I hope that things go back to normal and you can start showing your face to people again. And
exactly. Me too. I am hopeful too, but of course we have to be patient and, we have to just follow the rules and let's see what will happen.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Very good. So thank you again. Thank you very much for you, Teacher Fiona, to just join this conversation. Very lovely conversation we had. And of course, in the future, I'm not sure. I have some other plans, some other questions, some other topics, challenging topics, maybe. We can, if you are available, we can just do it the same way, more of a, you know, discussion, you know, in a sort of discussion way. But until that time, we have to just be patient.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I'm here, and yeah, let me know if you've any further ideas, because yeah, I love to kind of chat to other people. I'm here on my own. I love to chat to people.
Great. So. That is really cool. Really cool. Okay.
Right. Lovely.
Lovely. Yeah. Lovely talking to you again. So take care of yourself and enjoy your day.
Well, and likewise.
Thank you very much. See you soon. Bye bye.
Bye bye.
See you.